we thank you that you show your love by the wonderful grace that causes the sick and the diseased to be healed, that causes those, O Lord, who are tormented in their mind and their spirit to be set free and filled up with joy. Father, we thank you for the living glory of your presence. Thank you, Lord, for this wonderful privilege of having relationship with you, to walk with you, having you walking in us and with us. Oh, Lord, you're amazing. Amazing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for the language of heaven. Thank you, Lord, for the intercession of the Holy Ghost.
Your praise shall continually be. Lord, at all times. Your praise shall continually be in my mouth. Oh, I will bless the Lord at all times. Your praise shall continually be in my mouth. I will magnify you, Lord. I will magnify. I'll exalt your name forever. I'll exalt.
You are. soul, my mind. Oh, my heart, my soul, my mind, I worship you. Oh, my heart, my soul, my mind. Oh, my heart, my soul, my mind, I worship you. Oh, my heart, my soul, my mind. Oh, my heart, my soul, my mind. Part of my being to you, come reign through me. I surrender my whole heart, soul, and everything I am. Oh, reign through me, oh Lord. Blessed is the name of the Lord. Blessed is the name of the Lord. Oh God, take your power, come reign. Blessed is the name of the Lord. Oh Most High, oh, blessed is the name of the Lord. Jesus Christ, blessed is the name of the Lord. Oh God, come take your power and reign. Blessed is the name of the Lord. I yield my life to you, oh Lord. Blessed is the name of the Lord. I surrender everything to you. Blessed is the name of the Lord. Oh, mighty God, take your power and reign. Take your power and reign. Come around, come reign. Reign, 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 God, reign over me. Take your power and reign. Reign, 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 reign over me. God, take your power and reign. Come reign, reign, reign over me. Oh Lord, take your power and reign. Come reign, reign, reign over me. Spirit, reign, oh, reign over me. Take your power and reign. Reign over me. Oh, blessed is the day. Just like it's done in heaven. Your will be done in this earth right now. Just like it's done in heaven. Your kingdom come, Lord Jesus. Your kingdom be revealed in this with your signs and your wonders, Lord, your miracles, with the love, the joy, the peace that only you can bring, with your signs and wonders now, all your miracles, with the love, the joy, the peace that only you can bring. Hallelujah.
You can be, just go ahead and have a seat. And you know, I think that if anybody looks around and for just a moment takes a glance, they can see really just how bad things are in this world, and how evil men are. I mean, they're very wicked men that are in charge and that are executing the will and the mind of Satan. And if people don't want to say it's the will and the mind of Satan, it's very evil. It's very evil. We have, the count is right now approximately 58 million babies have been slaughtered in the United States of America alone since Roe versus Wade 1973. We've come to a place that we've said, God, we're not going to go with your ways and the way that you define life. On every level now, nothing's been left out. And somebody recently asked me just the other day, what, is God sleeping? If he's there, why doesn't he wake up and do something? And I try to explain to people, well, what you don't understand and what the majority of the church doesn't understand is that after that Jesus purchased our lives with his own blood, rose up from the dead, and went into the realms of heaven, he empowered the church to stand in his place and execute his will. And we want God to come and do it. And he says, no. I've given the power and I've given the ability. Listen, I'm telling you right now. Somebody said to me recently, they said, actually just yesterday, said, well, listen, I mean, you know, everything's going to go south anyway. So, you know, why is it the church's fault? Oh, no. The apostasy is symptomatic to a church that has gone to sleep. Let me put it in another way. The world being in such wickedness that the Supreme Court can make same-sex marriage equal to traditional marriage, Planned Parenthood selling baby parts, livers, hearts, kidneys, and making sure that they don't crush them while they're killing a screaming baby in the womb. And that's okay, and that's all acceptable. All that is symptomatic to, at best, a church that's totally asleep and has abdicated its power. And it almost seems like that certain segments of the church, all they're doing is having one big party. Another segment of the church, they don't even care. Another segment of the church is doing some liturgy. It's about time we grow up and go ahead and move on into the authority. You know, in Isaiah, the prophet said, there's darkness over the land and gross darkness over the people. But you can arise and shine, for your light has come. Now understand, there wouldn't have been gross darkness over the people and gross darkness over the land if God's people had been shining. There'd have been light. God's just talking to a covenant people who've lost their way, who Father said to Israel, I've given you the power. I'll give you the power of the kingdom. He says to the church, I give you the keys to the kingdom. And we've got many things that we're doing and many ideas that we're pursuing. But I tell you right now, all the indications are in. The report card can be read. At best, we're asleep. At worst, we're apostate. A minister of the gospel said to me, it's been a number of years now. He says, Mark, you think we have missed
in sections of the Bible. I said we've missed whole books of the Bible. Not just a few chapters here and there. We've not just left out a little part of it. We've been so overtaken by the world and ensnared by the world, we just really don't understand what God has done. See, the Lord has come, and He's taken an alabaster box of anointing oil, and He broke it over our heads, and when it fell upon us, exceeding joy and pleasure so filled our soul that we're not thirsty for anything that Satan's doing in the world anymore. And very few people even get this. A study was done that showed, and there's been a number of different studies like this, that showed that people are only happy at best 20% of the time. Now that's taking in everybody. And somebody said, well, they didn't come and interview me. Well, the good, that I'm glad you feel that way about yourself. But reality of it is that the prince of the power of the air, the god of this world, the atmospheric thing that is going on, that mindset, if you would, of humanity is only happy about 20% of the time. Only happy about 20% of the time, if I didn't say that right. Only happy about 20% of the time. 80% of the time, they're very unhappy. They're depressed. They feel intimidated. They feel like a failure. They can't get the grades that they need to get. They can't perform in the job that they need to, in the way that they feel that they need to be able to perform. They can't, you know, please their husband or please their wife, or they're failing their kids, or it just goes on and on and on. People just, that's just people living under this yoke. And Father came in His mercy and His love, and He sacrificed His only begotten Son for us at Calvary's tree so that we could be set free from the yoke of slavery that was held over our lives that causes all of this oppression and all this evil and all this iniquity and all this sickness and all this disease. The Lord Jesus didn't die to give men a permission to continue on in the life as they've been living it under the prince of the power of the air. He died at Calvary's cross to open up the door so that anybody who wants to come in to a realm called heaven, to a realm called abundant life, to a realm called glory, to a realm called relationship and oneness with Him, they can step on in. And that's what He was talking about when He spoke to the woman at the well, and He said, if you just recognize who I am and the gift of God, I would give you to drink, and you would never, something would happen to you that you would never thirst again. And what's going to happen to you that you would never thirst again is that the oil of joy is going to be bust loose. The oil of joy is going to bust loose on the inside of you, because Father is going to anoint you with this oil of gladness that He's anointed, a special anointing for the last days, which He's anointed, Jesus could have said, Himself with. And of course, I'm paraphrasing, I'm adding all the things in that belong to this wellspring of life, this very life of God living and dwelling on the inside of God's people. I dare say that many of God's people that are sitting here in this place tonight, you just really haven't understood how to allow the Holy Spirit who's with you and in you to take control of your life and run your life. I dare say that many of you, though you've had certain breakthroughs in your life, and you know, we just confronted some of those things that were hindering you on Sunday night, that you've really not awakened to the reality of the living presence of God. And I'm going to tell you why. The five senses have a huge impact on your life. And many people have never gotten enough insight and revelation from the Lord to realize that there's happening more in the unseen realm than is happening in the seen realm. And you're going to have to be willing to shut down the impact of that which your five senses behold if you're going to be able to function in that which God the Holy Spirit has granted to us, so that we can live in a heavenly realm and represent the heavenly realm. Now listen to this. If there is anything that we could say about right now, I mean, I don't even know how Israel is going to allow the Iran agreement to go down. I don't even think it's going to happen. I believe that Israel is going to invade Iran. And, you know, that all these things are being destabilized. I mean, it's like some sinister plan that somebody instigated to destabilize society at every level. Listen, I'm going to tell you, Caesar Augustus tried to save Rome by making adultery a death penalty act.
Because he recognized if you decay the human family unit and humanity through immorality, society will collapse. And I could go on and on through history and look at this, and everybody knows this. And that's why in the People's Republic of China right now, you're not going to see on the television what you see here. They're governing that. They recognize you cannot allow immorality to run rampant like this. You've got to preserve the human, the family unit and the human morality. Otherwise, we're going to lose our society, and they don't want to lose their society. You know, and Putin's standing around right now with all of his Orthodox bishops talking about how immoral and hideously, immoral the United States of America is. And today, you know, when we've seen this new video go viral of where they're selling off baby parts from aborted children, and we know it's already worse than that. I'm going to tell you right now. The best harvest of stem cells is going to be from human tissue, and that means you create human fetuses for the specific use of stem cell research and development, tissue development. I mean, I'm telling you right now, these things are unprecedented in human society. This isn't alarmism. This isn't exaggeration. This is unprecedented in human society. I'm telling you right now, the end is very near. You better wake up. This is unprecedented in a human society. You cannot look back in history and see anywhere in history where a government, any government, even some minor government, especially a noted international leader, a premier government, has done what we have done, where we have licensed the killing, the slaughter, approximately 58 million children, in the U.S. alone, think about it. And then to say, to make a law that same-sex marriage cannot in any way be frowned upon or condemned or has to be supported and is something that is viewed as right and good. It's just unprecedented in human history. All it is a sign of the time, and I pray that you'll wake up and realize that what God has done is he's placed within the framework of the church all the power to do everything that he himself would do if he was standing here physically right now. He gave all the authority of the church. I mean, we can sit around and talk about we're more than conquerors and we're overcomers through Jesus and we're supposed to be. And we can talk about how that we're heirs of God and co-inheritors with him and how we've been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire and how that we're supposed to run with the authority of the gospel, and we're supposed to, and we need to talk about that. But it's another thing to get into a place where you now begin to live this out and Satan has no power over you to hinder you and stop you from advancing the kingdom of God. I'm not interested in pointing fingers at anybody, because we're in the mess up to our eyebrows, every one of us. It's obvious to me. It's just that there are some people like myself who are passionately crying out, going, what on earth is going on? You know, people just want to, so many folks, they wanted to find things based upon their understanding rather than with hunger and thirst and passion reach in to what God has given. And so tonight, I want to just once again, I want to introduce to you what God has given. I want you to recognize what we have the right and the privilege and the ability to live in, but we're going to have to change. We're going to have to stop being conformed to the world. We're going to have to stop being conformed to the social structure, however you want to flavor it. I mean, you know, instead of saying the Murder Institute of Unborn Babes, they call it Planned Parenthood. What do you call your unwillingness to obey God fully? You know, what do you want to, you know, what we'll do is this. We want to go ahead and instead of saying conformed to the world, you know, we want to, when that's really maybe what we're doing, we want to make it something different. Like, you know, we've all got to live in this world and we've all got to get along with people and whatever, however it is that we want to paint it up and color it up and make it sound better and look better. But what we're going to have to do is we're just going to have to get real, because I'm going to tell you, the Spirit of Grace, that's another name for the Holy Ghost. One of the names of the Holy Ghost is Spirit of Grace. One of the names for the Holy Ghost is Spirit of Truth. One name for the Holy Ghost is Spirit of Holiness. He's come to lead us and guide us. One of the great names for the Holy Ghost is Comforter, Helper, Teacher, the one who's always there with us, the Advocate standing alongside of us. He's the Spirit of Prayer and Supplication. He said, God said, I pour out the Spirit of Prayer and Supplication on you. He's the Spirit of Grace. He's called the Spirit of Grace and of burnings, you know, to where that He brings to our heart a burning reality of who God is and what we're called to be and what we're purposed to do and how we're purposed to live. God's awake. We're sleeping. And I know that I will stand before the judgment seat of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I will give an account for living my life so lamely. And the only difference that might be between you and me is I know it and you don't. And if you know it like I know it, you're going to get fired up like I'm fired up. And you're going to get real passionate about no longer conforming to this world, but being transfigured. And I love the beautiful picture of what it looks like to be transfigured, hallelujah, by thinking different. I see Jesus transfigured in that intimate place of communion with the Father that, by the way, it's developed. It is developed. It's nurtured. And if you don't develop that and nurture that on a daily basis, you're going to never have it. Somebody said, oh, well, He's going to come to us as in sovereign moves, as the early and the latter rain. Yeah, He is, but the only people going to know that He came were those who are already developed that spiritual understanding to even recognize that He's come. Because people, I'm going to tell you, Jesus came in literal physical form. He took on the form of a human being. He was God manifested in the flesh. Listen to me. And people could not see Him. They could not recognize Him. Spiritually, they were not able to recognize who He was. That was never a place made alive in them. Many people are spiritually dead to what God is doing because they've never been born again. They've never called upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and had a change so that they could become alive to God. People have come to an ideology that somehow we're all the children of God. We're not. Jesus said that until you're born again, you're a child of the devil. It's a message that He preached in John chapter 8. People in the realms of humanism, they don't want to believe that. We live in a world right now where everybody believes they're right. They're justified in their own eyes. Listen to me now. Yeah, you can't convince anyone of sin. They've hardened the heart against the Holy Ghost. A rebellion has taken over the world that had its access through the church because the church is supposed to be the hinderer of iniquity. And it's obvious to see we're hindering nothing. It's obvious to see. I don't care what you want to, I don't care what little star points you want to make. This is unprecedented wickedness that has never existed in the history of mankind. Ever. Read your history books. I mean, the church has lived through some dark moments in time, but we've never lived in this type of wickedness. And one thing that we can see is, we can see, anybody who's got eyes to see, we can see that Satan is setting up and assembling right now because of the church's abdication, all that he needs to do in order to bring to pass the complete, as he would, annihilation of everything that looks like the Anointed One. And so I want to talk to you tonight about change. I want to talk to you tonight about the opportunity that God has given you. And I pray tonight that you will hear this as though you were hearing it for the first time. An opportunity to be transformed by the power of God and take up residence in heaven. I'm talking, you're going to have to just get rid of all of the stuff, get rid of your interpretation devices tonight. Just take them off and throw them on the ground and stomp them. Get rid of your interpretation devices, your translation devices, that you've already heard this and you know it. Because you've not heard it. Because if you've heard it in the Spirit, if you've heard it the reality in your life, everything's going to be different. The way that you respond to God, the way that you respond to the world, the way that you live in obedience to Him, the way that you recognize Him, the way that you shut down the activity of living by the five senses, what you think, what you understand, because you live in so much the mind of your own perceptions that really are about self-gratification, you cannot hear the mind of Christ. You cannot hear the mind of the Spirit. I don't care how much Scripture you know. It just doesn't work that way. You're going to have to come to a place to where that you say, okay, Lord, I'm going to follow You. And I'm talking to everybody from those who have just started your walk with the Lord to people who've been sitting around for years, okay? Because we want to get all of you moving in the same direction. We wanted you to just look at this opportunity that God has given. And open your Bibles here into Ephesians chapter 4. And we can see what Jesus did. He went and he won something for us. Okay? And so turn to Ephesians chapter 4, everybody. Are you there? And now look with me in verse 10. The scripture says, I don't want to look in verse 10. Look at verse 8. Wherefore, he said, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive, and he gave gifts unto men. Now, I want you to understand what all these gifts are that he gave. And I want you to look quickly, just in general, and quickly in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 4. What are these gifts that he gave? And how do they function? And how do they operate? Because I'm going to tell you, I see a great big misunderstanding in the land. I see a great big misunderstanding in the land on the side of that somehow people believe that they can continue in sin and that we're going to sin more or less every day and that they're right with God. That's a great big misunderstanding. I see people with a great big misunderstanding believing that they can function, operate in the gifts of the Spirit while they live lives compromised by the world system, compromised by sin. I'm telling you, it's a big misunderstanding because the Spirit of grace, the Spirit of holiness, the Spirit of truth is the one who operates all these gifts, and he doesn't function in that realm. I'm going to tell you, consecration has a direct impact on the way that you're going to function and operate in the Holy Ghost and move with him in his leadership and be directed by him. If you're directed in conducting your own life, I'm telling you right now, he's not going to push his way in and try to take over and start conducting your life. You know, people blaming God for stuff all the time. Listen, God didn't have nothing to do with it. What's happened to them was their own choices. People always blaming God for the hell that they're in. No. You chose the hell. God told you to do something different. God said, here's my way, walk in it. God, you said that it was okay to go ahead and do these acts of disobedience. It's okay to live this kind of a lifestyle that you weren't here hurting anyone. Hey, guess what? You discovered that you got hurt. You got hurt real bad. People say, I want heaven. Well, get rid of the leaven. You can have heaven. Because I'm a witness that you don't have to live in the wages of sin, which is death. If there's any key that you want to grab a hold of, it's that. But I'm going to tell you right now, if you try to live this by the letter of the law, you'll never do it. You're going to have to take a hold of the Spirit of life. That is another name for the Holy Ghost. He's the Spirit of life, just like he's the Spirit of grace, just like he's the Spirit of truth, just like he's the Spirit of prayer and supplication. This is who the Holy Ghost is. These are attributes of him. He's the Spirit of the fear of the Lord. He's the Spirit of counsel. He's the Spirit of wisdom. That's insight that allows you to know things that are not based upon experience or upon knowledge. Understanding is something that you can get. True understanding is something that you can get from the knowledge of the Lord that has been revealed. Wisdom is those things that Father unveils to us right out of heaven that has not based upon any knowledge whatsoever. It's just downloaded insight from heaven. And God, the Holy Ghost, is the one who is the Spirit of wisdom. And we have all of this wonderful privilege, all this wonderful authority, all this wonderful divine power available to us. And it seems that, once again, the five senses have just by and large shut all of this down. You know, we look at this like this. I mean, just take yourself, and if we picked you up and we took you out into a Holy Ghost camp meeting for 1 week, you'd find your spiritual feet underneath you. You'd find yourself elated in the realms of glory. You'd find yourself living carefree in submission to the things of the Holy Spirit. And you'd say, wow, this is a wonderful lie. This is a beautiful, beautiful realm of glory. What's taking me so long? Then we bring you back over here into your environment, and within 2 to 3 days, you're going to be back like you were. Why? Because you've never stood up against the opposing forces of darkness that you've allowed to influence you in every dimension. It's not just sin. It can be fear. It can be deceptions of harassment, strife, criticism, division, pressure upon your life because of finances. The list goes on. Things that you and I are going to have to be willing to walk away from because we've come into a wonderful revelation by the Holy Spirit of who God is, who he is for us on our behalf as our provider, as our protector, as our perfecter, as the one who began a good work in us, who will finish it, who wants us to be completely consecrated unto him. This is the challenge. People don't want to get this. They want to continue living their own lives because they've been indoctrinated by doctrines of men and of devils that it's okay to live your own life. The Lord said it's not okay to live your own life, because if you live your own life, you can never have all these things that I want you to have. And until you have all these things that I want you to have, you're never going to be a light to the world, and you'll never fulfill the responsibility and the call that I've placed upon the church. Amen. So Jesus highlighted in what he did when he purchased our souls with his own blood, highlighted in what he did when he redeemed us and brought us into this realm of being family members of God, being those who are heirs of God and co-inheritors with him, is he gave gifts unto men. Spiritual gifts. Spiritual gifts to confront unclean spirits, to cast them out. Spiritual gifts to command sickness and disease to go out of the body. Spiritual gifts to break off torment and lies, to deal with Satan at every point where he's manifested. That's the light. Without that, there is no light. And it's very clear that we're not shining, because darkness is over the world, over the earth, over America, over the communities, over the cities, over the states. And gross darkness over the people. And the good news is that the Lord says, rise and shine. We get an opportunity. It's an option. But I'm going to tell you right now, deception is a hard thing to break out of. The prison that you built around you, that you welded every bar, is hard to bust out of, because you become very comfortable in it. And somebody like me can stand here with the veins popping out of their neck and screaming and shaking the Bible and telling you to read, and it ain't going to change nothing. It ain't going to change nothing. Won't change anything. You're going to have to get hungry and thirsty and desperate for God to come deliver you. This is truth. The report card is in, dear people. The evidence is before us. These things aren't abstract. These things are very clear. And it's time for a change to take place. And the Lord he's not going to be set on that he's got to have a certain critical mass of people, a certain number of people. He's looking for anyone. Those who know the Lord in the last days, and we're in them, will be strong and they'll do great exploits. Don't tell me about how much you know the Lord. Let me see the exploits. Don't tell me about all your ideas and all your intimacy and whatever. Let me see the exploits. Because see, once again, it's the proofs. It's the evidence. The evidence of what goes on within the life of the believer that is under the influence of the Holy Ghost is clearly defined: love and joy and peace. If there's anything that we need to understand about the kingdom of God and about what God will do for those who are yielded to him, is that in all of our tribulation we'll be exceeding glad. There'll be a wonderful joy of the Holy Ghost in our life, because the kingdom of God's not meat and drink, but righteousness, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost. I want you to look here with me in this verse of Scripture, just as an overview of the gifts that he gave. And we can see right here in verse 4 of Hebrews chapter 2, he gave them gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his will. Here, these gifts of the Holy Ghost is all about the life and the ministry of Jesus. And the life and the ministry of Jesus is all about going everywhere and doing the work of the ministry, destroying the works of the devil. Works of the devil aren't being destroyed. Hello? The works of the devil aren't being destroyed. Not on any kind of mass scale. Maybe a little here, a little there. Not on any kind of mass. Not on a national scale. Not on what God ordained. He said, I give you the power and the authority to make disciples out of nations. I'm telling you right now, nations making disciples out of you and me. They schooling us, telling us where we're going to eat, what bowl we're going to eat out of. Hello? You listening to me? Telling you how much money you're going to make, how many hours you're going to work. It goes on, and it's getting ready to get real bad. I mean, you listen to me. I've been prophesying this for a number of years. I'm telling you right now, the thing's coming unraveled. You're going to wake up one morning, and you're going to find out that your dollars aren't worth anymore. Anything. It's just going to happen. It's going to happen that quick, and it's going to be so shocking, and there's no other way for it to come down, and it's going to come down that way. And I'm not praying, oh, God, preserve us. Oh, God, take care of us. I'm saying, Lord, let the thing collapse that men especially the church, might wake up. I'm asking God for the mercy. I'm not asking God based upon my own self-gratification saying, oh, Lord, I don't care really about 58 million, the slaughter of 58 million babies. I don't really care that much about it. I just want to have a cush life. Oh, Lord, it's okay if men want to defy you here in this nation and literally pollute the nations of the world through the iniquity that we produce right here. Oh, I don't care. Just as long as we have a cush life and everything's good and we don't have, you know, any war about us or any hunger or whatever. I'm not praying that way. I'm not praying, oh, God, let us have peace in the land. I'm saying, oh, God, whatever it takes to bust this sin out of this place, whatever it takes to bring this thing back around, whatever it takes to shut down abortion clinics, whatever it takes to shut down a corrupt government, do it now. And I'm going to tell you right now, he's going to answer my prayer.
Yes, he will.
And it's not only my prayer, it's the cries of his people, because it's not an act of judgment. It's an act of mercy, because people are so deceived. The church is so asleep. The church is so asleep that there have been very few voices that have even lifted up the cry against what happened when the Supreme Court did an unprecedented thing in the history of humanity. It was just evidence how that T.D. Jakes and other big preacher said, oh, it's nothing, it's meaningless, who cares about it, basically, is what they said. And I posted on my website, and I sent out, I said, look, this is what's going on, this is what's going on. This is the people that are now, that have the ears of the masses, and no wonder we lullaby to sleep. Because we all listen to this, and we think it's all powerfully anointed. And then you come around a person like me, and you say, oh, he's angry. I got a right to be. Things are messed up. People are listening to the wrong voices, doing the wrong thing. This isn't about, you know, the Lord doesn't need motivational speakers to tell you how wonderful you are and how you're going to be able to overcome and how you're going to be able to conquer and how you're going to be able to be plush and rich and pretty and whatever. You know, it's God the Holy Ghost is motivational enough. Just get over into the life. Come over here into the glory. Come over into the place where you have authority to cast out devils, where you have this authority to destroy the works of the devil, rather than the devil ripping through your life and destroying everything you got. The day Satan starts destroying anything in my life, destroying my life, my family, you know that I opened up the door through sin and iniquity. And it's nobody else's fault. That day, by the help and the grace of God, will never come. Because I'm more hungry, I'm more thirsty for the realms of his glory than I've ever been. I love the spirit of life. I love the spirit of truth. I love the spirit of grace. I love the spirit of supplication and prayer. I love the Holy Ghost, who is the comforter, the helper, the teacher, more than I've ever loved him. And he's come and revealed the Father to me. It's a wonderful, wonderful thing when you begin to step into a relationship with the Holy Ghost, where the Holy Spirit's able to reveal the Father to you, where you begin to hear him. Listen to me. This is not some kind of psychosomatic disease. You begin to hear him. This is not some kind of schizophrenia. You begin to hear him. You begin to recognize his presence. You begin to behold the beauty of who he is. I've heard a lot of people talk about that, but I'm going to tell you right now, there's a lifestyle, there's a change, there's a glory, there's a purity, there's a consecration to the things that he's commanded us to do that is revealed in the lives of everybody who's had that experience. You love his church more than anything else, and doing his work is something that you are now more empowered to do than ever before. And people, it's not about any other thing than just growing up. I know people hate to hear this. They hate to hear that they're just a baby. Oh, I'm just a baby. Well, I mean, goodness, if you don't want to hear that you're a baby anymore, just grow up. Somebody asked me today, they said, you know, is it possible that I only went halfway with the Lord? I said, no, you've gone all the way. You've been born again. It's just that you're a newborn babe. And as soon as you wake up to the reality that you need to eat, you're going to feel a lot better. Now, we got some baby orphan calves, and we just have to shove the bottle in their mouth. They don't want to take it at first, and you just got to kind of gag them with one finger and get that mouth open, get the bottle in there, and start squeezing it because they don't even know how to drink. But before long, they latch on that. And once they latch on, man, they jumping around when they see the bottle coming 20 foot away. You know? A lot of God's people have just simply not understood that as newborn babes, you're supposed to desire the sincere nourishment of the Word. It's a spiritual nourishment that God, where God's Word will be again to work mightily in you, that through the power of the miraculous working of God's Word, you begin to now have the mind of Christ and the mind of the Spirit dominating and ruling you, so that you're so built up in the faith that you just take it. You're not moved, man. Satan rises up and you smash him. There's too many people that just lay down to sickness and disease. They got a problem. They're just going, oh, woe is me. Why does it always happen to me? Why me? Why not? These bad things are going to happen to you. This crisis is going to happen to you until you learn how to come over and live in the place where the blessings, all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm exist. Jesus paid the price. Listen, a friend got beat up last night for the gospel. He went into on a reservation, took a drunk guy back, and he himself is Native American, and they thrashed him. They just beat him. Okay? And he was saying to me this morning, he's a new Christian. He says to me this morning, he said, why didn't Jesus fight for me? I said, dude, you're asking the wrong questions. Listen, you ought to be rejoicing that you got to be beat up for Jesus. I'm going to tell you, Christ Jesus is going to do what he does in a realm unseen. All the demonic powers that have ruled over the Klamath Indians are being busted down right now because of your blood on the ground. It's being busted. It's being broken down. Somebody's being willing to suffer. Somebody's being willing to do whatever it takes and not come under the fear. I said, what if you had to be beat up every day so that all the Klamath Indians could be saved? He said, okay, I'm willing. I'll get beat up every day. And I believe him. I believe him. He's a cowboy. He could take a beating. But ultimately what happens is the spiritual strongholds of hell are broken down through someone's willingness to go all the way with God, no matter what that looks like. And Father took us to a whole nother level where it's our weapons of our warfare, not carnal, but their God power. He gave to us this outpouring of the Holy Ghost. He gave to us these spiritual gifts. He gave to us the gifts of the Holy Ghost so that we can do this same exact thing that he's doing. Why is it that we want to settle out for something less? Why can't we go back and learn from those guys who had great outpourings of the Holy Ghost? Just even 60 years ago, 100 years ago, look at their consecration. Look at the sermons that they preached. I don't think that by and large, anyone today in a modern church is going to sit and listen to a preacher from 100 years ago, because it was such radical call to holiness, to consecration, to purity, to living in obedience to the Holy Ghost, to not having anything to do with this world, not having the smell of the world on you, not having the look of the world on you. Uh-oh. That's pretty radical, eh? Listen to me now. And for me, it's not about the clothes that you're wearing. It's about your behavior. It's about the thoughts that you're thinking. It's about the attitudes that you're having. It's about the wishy-washiness. Listen, we get to see a contrast between those who remain children and those who are going on to maturity, into the fullness of the maturity of the ministry of Jesus. Those that are children, you know what's going on with them? They're being constantly tossed back and forth. They're up and down. They're going from one crisis to the next crisis, from one sorrow to the next sorrow, from one problem to the next problem. Can't ever get ahead. One step forward, two step backwards. That means you're losing a step every day. You know what? Or at best, two steps forward, one step backwards. So half your effort is basically busted in half. So it's just very, very clear. I don't look like a child. I don't have that going on. I don't have no crisis from day to day. I live in glory from day to day. I'm finding myself continually being blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. I find myself in a greater connectivity with what God is doing, with a greater passion, a greater hunger, a greater faith. I find myself further and further from relating to anything in the world, more and more greed, more and more unable to associate with anything that's coming out of the pollutions of the world. It's called maturity. We want you just to mature. I'm going to tell you, God cannot have an army of diaper crawlers. Okay? Pacifier diaper crawlers. Okay, are you with me? Here comes the army. They got a little sword. They're dragging it behind them because it's tied around their neck, but they got the passy in the mouth and they're crawling and they got a big bundle of diaper on them. Because that just doesn't, that's just, they don't even know how to speak. It's just a goo-goo gaga at the enemy. Nothing's going on. We're going to have at least an army of children. We're going to have at least an army of 5 and 6 year olds. I mean, that could potentially be a little terrifying. But how about if we had matured sons of God, young men? The young men is defined by those who are battle ready. That's not going to happen because you're having a party at the meeting. That's going to happen because something happens in your life to where the Holy Ghost conviction falls upon you. A burden from the Lord, the spirit of prayer and supplication is there, and it drives you to your face. It drives you to your knees. It drives you to a place of crying out to God. And now sometimes things begin to happen. Father has given us an authority through prayer that very few people understand. He's given us the authority to bring people, individuals, to bring people groups, to bring nations to the throne of heaven. It's pretty radical, eh? He's given us an authority to see yokes broken off, demon power totally disrupted, radical change take place in our own lives and in other people's lives, the privilege of being able to take someone and bring them and highlight them in the presence of the Father. A situation. I mean, just imagine with me, if Father doesn't see anything, just imagine this with me because you'll get the impact. He doesn't see anything until it's brought before him through prayer. He doesn't see it. He's not involved with it. He's not in any way associated with the knowledge of it. A person, an event in your life, a disaster, a catastrophe, whatever. A storm about to come, he doesn't know anything about it until someone brings it to him and says, Father, there's a storm coming. We're asking right now that the storm be stopped. And he sees it because someone knows and comes to the power and the authority of prayer, who's now a covenant partner with him, who has access by the Spirit to him. And he goes, okay, it's done. It's stopped. See, this is the relationship that whatever we ask the Father in Christ Jesus' name, he will do it. And he's placed it within our charge. And he says to us, Son of Man, what do you think about the condition? What do you think about the abortion clinic? What do you think about the 58 million souls? How many prayers have you prayed about it? How much have you brought it to the throne of grace? What do you think about the condition of the church and the rampant pornography and strife and envy and all the rest of the stuff, the place and the state of people living in slumber and sleep? Whole list, whatever it may be, the divorce rate within the framework of the church, the broken covenants, the fact that you got a church that's wandering around from place to place because they can't get along with each other, and evidence that they're living in hate instead of love, broken covenant instead of covenant, they're living in condemnation and war instead of peace. These are evidence. It isn't guesswork. It's not guesswork, people. It's not some spin. It is the data. It is the evidence. It is the written proof of action and activity and state of being. And in looking at the evidence and looking at what's really there, this suddenly we begin to draw correct conclusions about things so that we know really where are we at right now. Because we could live in make-believe. And too much of the church lives in make-believe because they think that their whole relationship is just all about their Sunday morning experience in church. They think that their relationship is all about a confession booth or just responding to an altar call instead of responding to God in a relationship with them and say, Lord, I want out of this. See, Christ Jesus is calling out to everybody who wants to be set free from the sin and the iniquity and the chaos. He says, I've got a place of safety. I've got a place of life forevermore. I've got a place of joy, love, and peace. I've got a place of all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Anybody like to live in this realm? I will transform you. I will change you. I will make you a new creation so you are fit to come and live in this realm. Anybody who wants it. See, there's a misunderstanding. People don't realize that that is what God is calling out. He's calling out to people who don't want to live in sin anymore. He's not calling out to people who like to live in sin, but they want to be religious too. He's not calling out to people who are just happy with the way their life is going. They got it pretty good under control, but you know what? Nothing wrong with having a little Jesus salt on my potatoes. No problem having a little flavor of religion in my tea. We're going to have to recognize that we've compromised. There's been compromise. There's been comparisons. Huh? And there's been competitions. All demonic. You listen to me? You're trained to be competitive. Competitive has nothing to do with the kingdom of God. And out of that competition, now you're constantly now in competition with people around you, comparisons. They all always go together. And now out of that, you can justify yourself in your own eyes, comparing yourselves one with another. The only person you want to compare yourself is with Jesus, because God, the Holy Ghost, came so that you and I could be taught how to live the life of Jesus. That's what sanctification is all about. That's what consecration is all about. That's what this work of redemption is all about. That's what He is, the Spirit of grace, Spirit of truth, is wanting to show us how to live a life full of joy. So where you're not, you know, happy 20% of the time. But you're happy 100% of the time. But what if you measured your life? What if you actually took good inventory of your life? And you got up in the morning and, you know they have these little meter watches now, right? That can, what are they called, baby? They just track your distance and your time and your, you know, how many miles you walked or ran or whatever. What if you just had something like that and measured how happy you were? I believe a lot of you would be shocked. And it would be in a direct correlation because of how that your lack of talking with the Father, your lack of yielding to the Holy Ghost. Sunday night, the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me so strong about dealing with the things that stand in people's way, hindering them from moving forward. There are so many things. I love reading the Word to come to understand the things that allow us to be more receptive and submitted to the Holy Spirit, and the things that would hinder us and block God from giving and supplying things which He's freely given already to anyone who will receive. Because then we get to know a little bit more about the consequences of our action. We get to understand a little bit more about what we need to be doing with our life and where we need to be focused on in our life. I mean, the Lord wants to come bring you to a place where you walk in and joy 100% of the time. Huh? I mean, what if you had a complaint meter on your wrist? You're going to discover exactly why you're stuck. But listen, if you would just give yourself to the nourishment of the Word of God, if you would give yourself to an obedience to the nourishment of the Word of God, if you would give yourself to just recognizing the Holy Spirit is with you and in you, and that He's leading you and guiding you, He's the comforter, He's always right there to help, He's always right there to bring provision, He's always right there to rescue. You know, Peter, he cries, he's walking on the water, he begins to sink, he cries out. Immediately, Jesus stretched forth His hand and He took care of him, right? That's what the Holy Ghost is. That's what the Holy Ghost does. Jesus said, I'm going to send you another comforter, helper, one to stand alongside of you, advocate just like me. And that's what the Holy Ghost is always doing. But how much interaction is going on in our lives? These are the things that we're going to have to begin to deal with. Why? Because if you're not yielding to Him, if you're not cooperating with Him, there's no light. If you're not yielding to Him, if you're not cooperating with Him, if you're not receiving that which He supplies, there's no salt. So the nation of the United States of America is obviously not being preserved, not in any holy state. And besides that, it's not even being preserved in any state, because we look at the complete decay and erosion of a society right before our eyes. Suddenly we're walking around with these little blindfolds on, acting like nothing's going on. Then then we want to blame everybody. That's just the first thing we all do. We blame somebody. Oh, it's his fault. It's their fault. It's that thing's fault. No, it's our fault. Because God didn't give legislative and judicial powers to deal with the social evils of men. He gave the church. But the church is all sitting at the table in the eating of the same spiritual death that the world is. Sitting at the table in front of the television. Sitting at the table in front of the immorality. Sitting at the table in the front of murmuring and complaint and offense and strife and division and broken covenant and on and on and on. And we act like there's no consequence. There's a consequence. Here's the worst part. I have watched it. I've been in the church all my life. 56 years I've been in the church. And I've watched how that so many people have broken covenant and done things that are just as bad as sin and iniquity, as immorality of any sort, lust of flesh, lust of the eye, and pride of life. And they've never repented. Because they self-justified. They said that they had a right to do it because somebody did something to them. And it could have been something as ridiculous as taking their seat or didn't talk to them or gave them a dirty look, whatever that is, a mean look. Or the preacher didn't talk to them, or the preacher preached a harsh sermon, they didn't like it. All these justifiable reasons. They're not justifiable reasons. You did those things which are wrong, and now you want God to bless you. And he's saying, no, you got to repent. You got to repent. Will he forgive us as many times as we need to be forgiven? And then what happens? What happens so much in the church is now what we're going to do is we're going to try, because we got to do something to justify our state of existence. So now what we're going to do is we're going to create an environment so we can get a lot of people saved, supposedly. So that our sermons and the activities of the meeting is all about getting whoever's there to come up front and become a part of the church. And we're saying to come up front and give their life to Jesus. But did a change take place? Did a heart change take place? That's really the big question. Because when a heart change takes place, there's going to be the power of the Holy Ghost released to do it. And if the Holy Ghost is not being welcomed and not allowed, how is he released to do it? How you know that it's just all it was a man-made thing, and it was a religious activity because it was man-controlled. The Holy Spirit is the one who's come and is supposed to be in charge of the church here tonight. He's supposed to be in charge of your listening. He's supposed to be in charge of your heart and your responsiveness. He's supposed to be in charge of every word that comes out of my mouth. You know, I just wanting to help people understand where I'm at. You know, I put on my Facebook and tweeted the other day, just, I choose to see Father sitting on the front row of the meeting so that everything that I say can be evaluated by him. I'm looking for what he said. What do you say? Am I doing? If he's sitting there shaking his head going, uh-uh, then I need to be quiet. If he's going, then I'm right on the right page. Every word's being evaluated. The problem is people are stubborn. They don't want to change. They want to say, they want you to come to them and say, you're doing good. That's a wonderful little crawl there. And that's fine. You know, that's fine, especially if you've only been walking with the Lord for 5 years. But then it's like, you know, it's time for some reproof and some rebuke. You're not even crawling anymore. You've become paralyzed. Oh, I can't believe it. He's calling out my condition. We understand how that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost, who went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil. We understand that Jesus was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. We understand that right now, Jesus has all authority in heaven and earth. Listen, all authority in heaven and earth. Nothing is allowed to happen unless he allows it. But we have to also understand that within the context of all of that authority, he's placed the church in a place of this delegated authority to where that we execute that authority, and if we do not execute it, it doesn't happen. Although he has all authority, let me put it like this. Father sent the Lord Jesus. Father remained in an hidden and unseen realm. Father did nothing other than what he did through Jesus. So Jesus said, it's not me doing the work, it's the Father doing the work. Jesus has placed the church, you and me, in his stead, even as the Father placed Christ Jesus in his stead. And Jesus is not doing anything unless he does it through you and me. If Jesus would have shut down and said, no, I'm not going to do anything. I've decided I'm going to get married, have family, stay here in Nazareth. I'm thinking about maybe going ahead, moving to Cairo where nobody knows me. Because I decided I want to be a camel farmer. I'm done with this thing. I've already looked into the future. I understand how bad men are. No, he just know what he did. He obeyed God. He laid down his life. He took up his cross so that the will of the Father may be executed, so that Father may be revealed and may be seen. You and I, we just think that we can just do whatever we want to do. It's like it's inconsequential. No, you're responsible for creating an environment of faith in this place. You're responsible for giving yourself over to the Holy Spirit so he can build you up as a spiritual house where the spiritual sacrifice and praise can be offered to the Lord in this place so that the glory of God may be seen in the earth. That assignment is ours individually, and that assignment is ours collectively. And be certain, you are most, and I am, every one of us, we are going to give an account for this responsibility that was entrusted unto us that we've never... We better get a hold of, because we can't run the risk of not getting it. You can't run the risk of stubbornly sitting captivated by your own wishes, your own whims, your own desire, what you want, what makes you happy, what pleases you, and forget about everything else, because that's an act of rebellion and treason against God. Father's called us to come and follow him, to lose our lives so that he could be revealed through us. Because it can't work any other way. And he gives us so much grace. He gives us so much mercy and so much forgiveness. I mean, give me a church full of people that are committing sin every day, but every day they are asking God to forgive them. They want to get it right. And I'm going to tell you right now, there's going to be nothing but encouraging words. Give me a church full of people, and they're sitting there, and they're stubborn, and they don't want to change, and they're not willing to obey, and there's going to be a bunch of screaming and hollering. And the belt's going to be flying. Huh? And before long, because it's going to, it continues to erode. Well, we're not going to do, we won't go that far in leadership today, because it's truly become Laodicean, where everything is about pleasing the people, and the spirit and the atmosphere of what Satan is doing and that rebellious influence that he has, he places it in the psyche, if you would, of all mankind to say, we don't have to be treated like this. No one can tell us what to do. Why are you treating me like a child? How is it that I'm your punching bag? And all the rest of the crazy nonsense that demonic lies want to speak against the truth. Why is it that you don't accept me like I am? Because he wants to change you to be like he is. Because like you are, you don't want to be like you are. I'm going to help you understand something. You don't want to be you. Not when you can be him. You don't want to have what your hand can provide for you when you can have what his hand provides for you. Why would you live your life in mediocrity and shame and obscurity when he's purposed for you to rise up and shine with his divine power and glory? Why would you live your life just assimilated within the community of humanity when he's reproduced his son in you and me? When he's purposed to bring forth this precious fruit of the earth where Christ Jesus is fully revealed. And this is going to cost you something. Everything that you've been taught by the devil, you're going to have to not allow it anymore. The Spirit of grace came and has taught you to deny it, not allow ungodliness and worldly lust. All that stuff that where all the pleasure center is and what everybody's running after and they think it's weird that you're not in it too. Huh? God says, you're going to have to shut that down. You shut that down, you can have heaven. That's challenging. He's come and He's given us His righteousness. He's given us the gift of righteousness, the gift of holiness, the gift of being totally acceptable to Him. We don't have to come to Him wanting Him, wanting, desperately wanting to have a relationship with Him and then feel all unclean and all undone and unacceptable and can't come in. And then the Lord saying, hey, you got to sit out there on the porch because you just, you know, you can't come in here yet. You're too messed up. And we just got to sit out there on the porch. We so want to be with Him, but we can't be with Him because we're just so messed up. No, He totally cleanses us, washes us, totally makes us acceptable, holy and acceptable to Him, so that no matter who we are and what we are, we get to come in. I mean, it's beautiful. Looking at the woman who was an adulteress, who comes in, falls down at the feet of Jesus, and she gets to receive more of heaven than all of the learned scholars that were in the room, who knew the Bible from cover to cover and knew all the stories of the history of God's people, and they weren't getting nothing. All they wanted to do was express to Jesus what they knew. They wanted to rejoice in their intellect. Here's a woman who wants to touch heaven. She comes, falls down at His feet, and begins to cry because she discovers that there is forgiveness at His feet. There's forgiveness in His life. There's mercy with God. Hallelujah. He's the one who forgives sin and washes completely away. There's enough people in this place tonight to surrender yourself to the Holy Ghost. I'm not talking to you about all the things that you would do out of your intellect to try to get yourself straightened out. I'm talking to you about coming to a place where you submit and surrender yourself fully to the Holy Ghost. To where the spirit of burnings begin to work in you. Where the spirit of supplication begins to work in you. Whew. Where the spirit of judgment begins to work in you. These are all things that Zechariah or Isaiah said about Him. Where the spirit of truth begins to work in you. Where the spirit of revelation begins to work in you. The unveiling of the person of God. The unveiling of who God has made us to be in Christ Jesus. To reveal the fullness of His glory. The impact of His person through our lives. I'm going to tell you right now, you may not understand this. God made you more than a human being the day you were born again. God made you more than a human being than the day you were born again, because Christ Jesus was formed in you. He's more than a human being. God made you more than just an average, ordinary person born of a mother and a father, because He put His Holy Spirit in you, and you became that day when you were born again the very temple of the Holy Ghost, the very habitation of the Almighty God. To be become so special to Him that He's come to not be only with us, but in us, but also to think about, you know, the fact that He is with us, to mentor us, to lead us, to guide us, to talk to us, to speak to us. But He's not going to speak when we've got all of our head running around with a bunch of criticism, a bunch of crazy ideas, a bunch of unholy thoughts. It's time that we begin to allow the Holy Ghost to give us a consciousness where we're aware of, a conscious awareness that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be holy and acceptable. Where it's not just rote memorization. I mean, there's a great thing that can happen to you when you just meditate on the Word and you just think about the Word. You just speak the Word. You rehearse the Word of God. It's another thing when God, the Holy Ghost, is burning it in you. It's just on you. It's just in you. You look, you see the world, you perceive it differently. If your eye is evil, you're going to see the world in a very ugly way, in a very negative way. Everything's going to be bad, and everything's going to be hard, and it's not working because your eye is evil and your whole body is full of darkness. But if your eye's good, you're going to see everything that God is doing, and only the Holy Ghost can create a good eye. You know, Jesus said there was those who came to Him, and He likened the kingdom of heaven unto this, and some worked all day for a denarii, and others came and only worked 1 hour, and they got a denarii too. And He says, no, He said, I give everybody the same. I'm giving everybody the same wage. I don't care how long you've been in. You got the equal opportunity. I don't care if you've been saved today. You can be baptized with the Holy Ghost and full with the anointing of the Holy Ghost and go and do the works of Jesus. Or if you've been saved, 100 years and you still haven't got it, you still got the opportunity. Right now, everybody's getting the same wage, both here and later. And then he looks at those who are all upset because, you know, when they came, they were there all day. And the guys who, you know, because he paid the last first, and he paid the first last, right? And they're expecting more, and now they're all upset. And they're murmuring and complaining. We bore the heat of the day and of the heat. We bore the day, we bore the work, labor of the day and the heat of the day and the sun. What is what they said. And he said, is your eye evil because I'm good? They were looking at the world through a self-centered, self-interest. What about me? It's all about me. And so their whole being is full of darkness. God wants you to start looking at all of life through His eyes, how it impacts Father. How is this impacting Father? How is what I'm doing impacting Father? The next time you're going to participate with sin, I hope you sit down and just take a quick look at the new YouTube that's gone viral about selling baby parts from these Planned Parenthood. And then just recognize that sin that you're getting ready to participate with is exactly the same. They all hooked up together. And so all you're doing is feeding into that. God has allowed this thing to go on. Some people have said, why didn't God just shut down sin so it isn't any longer? Because the Lord is allowing sin to go on as a testimony to all creation for all eternity, that the end of sin will always have the same conclusion. So you start off with just a complaint, a sin of complaint. Where it's going to ultimately lead to is to not want God to exist anymore. All sin ultimately feeds in to not wanting God or allowing God to exist anymore. Because of who He is and what He wants. He wants no evil. The light has sprung up, and men who sit under the shadow of death have seen great light. And yeah, there's going to be men who love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. But people, the light's got to shine. I know this. I know that the wickedness, the tares are growing. But I also know that the wheat is growing too. So as wickedness gets worse, the demonstration of the power of God is supposed to get greater. Where sin abounds, grace is supposed to much more abound. We understand that there is a realm that God has given us an opportunity to. But you listen to me. Jesus looked across time, and here's what He said. When He was standing there looking across time, when He was standing there looking by revelation into the future, and He's seeing the state of man, He asked this question. Uh-oh. Will there be any faith on the earth when the Son of Man returns? Because it is a choice. People want to make it a foregone conclusion. No. It's on the shoulders of our responsibility and willingness to cooperate with God. As for me and my house, we're going to serve God. We're going to go all the way with the Lord. People, I want you to get this. I want you to understand. Open up your eyes. That 2,000 years ago, Jesus said, behold, I come quickly. Today, I want you to understand something. It's all the more quickly. Now, like never before, things are being set up that will bring a worldwide and global devastation that will be the forerunner and preparation for the last day's events. It's going to be dark. You listen to me. United States of America is not Babylon. United States of America, however, can be allegorically in some way some of the things that will ultimately have its conclusion in the full-blown events of Babylon are seen repetitively over time. Understand that. Just like when you look at the seven churches, you can see those acts and those events and those states repetitive over time. I'm telling you right now, you listen to me. America doesn't have any place in Scripture. It's not even seen in Scripture. It isn't even relevant at the very last day. And we are approaching the very last day, and I'm telling you, it's by way of some very dark days. And I want you to be able to grab a hold of the faith and the authority that has been made available to you by the Lord Jesus Christ so that you can walk through the fire and not be burned. So that you can, as it were, pass through the water and not be drowned. Where that when there is no provision, when there is no clean water, when there is no food available, there is provision for you because you've learned how to step over into faith and stop living in fear. Everybody wants to get all sanctified and holy when they get to heaven. No. It's sanctification and holiness now so that you can step into the realms of heaven. People want to have faith in the time of great trouble. In the time of great trouble, somehow people have imagined that, at that moment in time, you know, I won't have anything else to do but serve God, and I'll really radically serve God. No, it's not true. No, you'll be worse off than you are now. It will be harder for you to serve God now. People think that they can somehow go through the tribulation and that they somehow are going to stand up as mighty, you know, stalwarts of the kingdom of God when people's heads are getting chopped off and all those stuff's going down, and they can't serve God right now in this plush environment. All they got to do is turn off the TV. Give me a break. It's your brain will play tricks on you. Your mind will play tricks on you. Always predict things about yourself in the future that aren't, it's just fantasies. It's time to get into reality. The spirit of reality is here. The spirit of truth is here. God, the Holy Ghost, Jesus, I want to close with this. Jesus died for you to have gifts. Gifts of the Holy Ghost. In every dimension of life, what are we talking about these gifts? We're talking about the spiritual state of heavenly armament and equipment to live out the life that God created us to have when He created us in Christ Jesus, to be the people that we're supposed to be when He created us in Christ Jesus, to walk in what Paul said in the word of wisdom and the word of knowledge and the discerning of spirits and the working of miracles. Miracle people. To command the wind and the waves. Hallelujah. To command the dead to rise to life again. To cast out devils. That's miracle power. Speaking with new tongues, heavenly language. It's miracle power. I love the heavenly language. It is supernatural. It's not something that I do. It's something the Holy Ghost does through me. And somebody says, well, can you do that all the time? Yeah, because the Holy Ghost will train you how to yield to Him all the time, so you're doing it all the time. And I'm going to say this. If the language of the Spirit was the measure of how much you yield to the Holy Ghost, how much of the day are you yielding to the Holy Ghost? And I'm going to tell you right now, I believe it is. Now, I want you to, you've got to measure. You have a measure. And the more you give yourself to the things of the Spirit, the stronger and the greater force and the more freedom and of the flow there becomes. And the more outworking of God is manifested through your life in the gifts of healing. And the gift of faith, well, what a powerful gift. My mother was raised in a Holy Ghost church, and great signs and wonders in church. Signs and wonders church in when she was a little girl, and now she was a pretty little thing, and so the preachers would come through, and they figured that she was a good candidate for wife. So, you know, she would go out with some of the preachers from time to time, but these guys were signs and wonders and miracles guy. And she's telling me about one particular guy, one great man of God, young man of God that came along before my dad came along. And he took her out and they were sitting in the car just, you know, talking. And he said, see that car over there? The car parked a distance away. He said, the light's going to come on now. As soon as he said, the lights came on. He's trying to impress her. He's using the gifts of the Spirit to impress her. No problem. You can do that when you know God like that. And he says, then watch, the light's going to go out. Let's go off. But the glory and the power of God is manifested in his life on every level. Just get to faith. Get to faith is a powerful thing. Just unfortunately, just a few people have stepped into that realm. Back in that day, there was a lot of people running around allowing the Holy Ghost to be developed in their life, the spiritual giftings of God. We want to just try to isolate God in a box and put Him in a human realm and put Him under human circumstances and human constraints, and then that's acceptable to us within the framework of religion. God ain't in that box. He's supernatural, miraculous God. He's seen in manifested in Christ Jesus, and Jesus said, this is the life I want you to live. I've got these gifts, I've won these gifts for you, so that the same anointing that I have, you have. The same baptism of the Holy Ghost, I'm going to give to you. There are so many people, they're just stuck. They understand the earthly ministry of Jesus to some degree, that he died at Calvary's cross for them, and that he was buried, and that he rose from the dead. But they don't understand that it's heavenly ministry that is ongoing right now to baptize in the Holy Ghost in fire, the unlimited authority of heaven poured out upon you and me to have the authority to be the sons of God, to walk in the full glory of that manifested power that Christ Jesus displayed. And he says it like this, anyone who believes We don't get this. We don't listen. Are you listening to me? Because I'm going to tell you right now, the power of God is here to create faith within you. If you will listen to me, if you will not bow your head once again in defeat and shame and spend 80% of your time unhappy because you just don't measure up in your mind. Are you listening to me? Because that's a stronghold of the enemy. God has said, anybody that believes these works, Jesus said it in the context that applies to you and me right now. I understand that it's hard to believe that God has given to us the gifts of the Holy Ghost. I understand. We can believe that He gave it to Peter and Paul and all the guys back there or somebody else, but not little old me, not me. If you understand, I mean, everybody can have it but me because I just don't measure up. That's the lie that keeps you from walking with God and being who He created you to be. It's the gift of God. He wanted gifts for us. He gave gifts to men. He gave to us the gift of the gifts by the Holy Ghost. He says, anyone who believes these works which I do, shall they do. He wasn't just, somebody said, oh, he's just talking to the disciples. The disciples aren't just, they are not all inconclusive, everyone. They are just 12 ones. Anyone, you should be happy. You should be thrilled. You should be soaking this up. The roller coaster ride of many people's spiritual life. Happy, hallelujah, one day. It's like bipolar. We're going to get you healed. Super happy and excited one day. Lethargic, we're going to get you healed. In Jesus' name, we're devoted to you being set free. The chains of darkness broken off of you. Then the thoughts of immorality will go too. And the thoughts of bickering and strife will go as well. Hallelujah. And the thoughts of fear and defeat, they'll go as well. Hey, hallelujah. Everything will become holy in your life and pure in your life. Ooh, karabashi pramamontaya. Hallelujah. Hey, people don't really realize how much bondage there is in immoral thoughts. There's such bondage there. They don't know because the whole world is all wrapped up in that. I want to emphasize something to you tonight. I want you to open your Bibles and I'm saying this because this is for you. He gave gifts unto men. You're them. The gifts of the Holy Ghost according to His will. The manifestation of the Spirit is given to every single person. I'm giving you verses of Scripture. I'm quoting them to you right now as I've read them in Ephesians 4:8 and Hebrews 2:4 and 1 Corinthians 12:7. They're yours. He won them for you. He's come and generously, as much as He gave His blood for us at Calvary, and it poured out from Him. So the Holy Ghost, the baptism of the Holy Ghost, and fire has been poured out. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you right now, it's time to rise up and begin to preach like never before. I mean, our dear friend Josh, you know, he goes and his grandfather was a chief in the Klamath Indian tribe, was kind of a rowdy guy, and he kind of has some repercussions about that in the Klamath tribe. And he goes and he picks up a drunk Indian on the side of the road, puts him in his car, and takes him home, and gets there and wants to pray for everybody. And everybody, their response was to beat him up. I mean, people, it's about time that somebody besides a person who just barely been saved for 1 year begin to take risk for Jesus. Begin just, I don't care what you do to me. I'm going to tell you the truth. I'm here to set you free. Hallelujah. You know, I'm here to display the power of God to you. Hallelujah. Come on, it's time that we get the whole counsel of God instead of just some little fragment of it. Huh? It's time we start rebuking and reproving people who for the wages of unrighteousness. It's true. If you love them, you will. Is you love them, you will. Oh, just no. We just want to make everybody happy. Just be nice to everybody. And just let them go to hell without saying nothing. No, that's not love. Instead of make another choice that's going to be disaster in their life. Let them make another choice that's going to cause them to be that much more distant from what the Holy Ghost is doing. Let them make another choice that's going to have death consequences around them. Trouble that they should have never had to inherit. Whirlwinds that they should have never had to reap. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to scream and holler at you. huh? If people are going to go to hell, as Spurgeon said, let them go with us with our arms wrapped around their knees, begging them not to take another step. They're going to have to crawl over top of us screaming and hollering, don't walk that way. Hallelujah. I want you to hear this relationship. This is the light. The Lord says, arise and shine, for your light has come. This is going to be the cure. Here's what the Lord says. We know the day is evil, but here's the cure. Here's the cure. You can redeem the time. Don't be drunk with wine where it is in excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Be baptized in the Holy Ghost. This is what he says. This is the redemption. Come on, listen to me. Listen to me. All of you guys, come on. I think that Trump's the best person on the field right now. He's the only guy that looks like he won't be in somebody else's pocket. He's just arrogant enough to be the guy, you know, who knows? I don't know. But he isn't going to be the solution. The remedy is you're going to start praying in the Holy Ghost. That's what the Lord said, Ephesians 5:18. He said, redeem the time, for the day is evil. Don't be drunk with wine where it is in excess, but begin to be filled with the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. In other words, be baptized in the Holy Ghost. Speak to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. What are we talking about? All day long, giving yourself to this development, the spiritual development, maturity. You know what? It's going to be really difficult if you don't have a diet of the Word to have this kind of flow of the Spirit. You listen to me. And it's going to be hard to start with if you've never done this more than 5 minutes in a day. Somebody said to me, I don't really keep time. You need to. I keep time. Why? Because I want it to increase. I want it to be more and more. I want to know where I'm at now. I want to labor for something more. Yeah, I'm going to tell you right now, I don't care what life it is, what dimension of life it is in, successful people are goal setters. They measure. I'm a goal setter. I measure. I know what I'm going after in God. That's more important to me than anything else in life. I want you to do this too, because you're not going to get anywhere until you're willing to do this. Your boss is measuring how many hours you're at work. You might wish they weren't, but they are, because they want to be profitable off of you. You need to start measuring the things that are most valuable to see change come in this nation. To see change. I want the satellites to come down out of the sky. I want the propagation of all this wickedness and evil that is flowing through those systems to come down. I want abortion clinics shut down. I want an evil and wicked government, an evil and wicked Supreme Court who basically by an unrighteous authority, an unlawful authority, trying to legislate over the United States of America and the people that are here in this nation, that they have to call good evil and evil good, that they have to love wickedness and hate righteousness. No, I want the stuff come down. There's going to have to be people who know how to redeem the time, to know how to give themselves over to the authority of Christ Jesus and begin to function in it. He's blessed it in our charge. When you understand it, all of a sudden, it's going to be a transition in the way that you think and you act, the way that you feel about things, the way that you believe Him for that which He's commanded. And in that state, we can find ourselves fully resourced with the authority of God. Listen to this. John chapter 14. Jesus says this. Verse 10. He says, don't you believe that I'm in the Father and that the Father is in me? Pretty radical, huh? He said, the words that I speak unto you, I'm not speaking them of myself. It's the Father that dwells in me. He's the one that's doing the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. And if you can't just believe that, believe me for the very work's sake. Now listen to what he says. And truly I tell you that the works that I do, anyone who believes, they will do also in greater works, because I go to my Father. And really what he's saying to us is he's telling us the description of the relationship and the intimacy and the power and the authority that is given to us when the Father comes to dwell on the inside of us by the Holy Ghost. I want you to get empowered here tonight. I want you to get out of 20% happy and 80% sad because you're overwhelmed and you're intimidated and you're never good enough. I'm good enough. Not by myself. God made me good enough. You can't ever make me not good enough. No one can take my integrity from me or my uprightness because mine came from Jesus. That's why I feel good all the time. When somebody's preaching hard and radical, and it's a radical, you know, even chastening, reproving word from heaven, I'm just soaking up going, yes, Lord, that's what I want. I'm not going. Because that's Cain. Cain does that. Huh? I'm not a Cain. I'm a son. Sons like reproof. Sons like correction because it just makes them stronger. They just get it straightened out that much more. It's time, come on. He was trying to be a son. It's time to be a daughter. It's time to be those who know how to receive correction. Hallelujah. A rebellious child will not receive correction. You know what the Lord said to him? Stone him. That you may crush sin out of the heart of Israel. I'm not going to be rebellious. I'm not going to ever look rebellious. I'm going to receive correction. Hallelujah. I'm not going to feel defeated and overwhelmed because I look to the rock who's higher than me. It's not me. It's Christ that lives in me. I'm not relying on human ability. I'm relying on his ability. Praise God. When he calls me to do something, I don't look to the arm of flesh. I don't look to what I can do. I look to what he's given, and I thank him for the resource and the ability. I'm not standing on my own 2 feet. I'm standing in him. Hallelujah. I'm not holding myself up. He's holding me up. Shikorabasteya. Got to get everybody healed here tonight. If you got a sickness, a disease, a sorrow, a problem, Christ Jesus is the answer. He is. I don't care what it is. All there has to be is a little bit of faith. You might be like, tonight you might be like the guy whose son was sore vexed of it and tormented of a devil. Who cries out, I believe, help my unbelief. Because he's thinking, I'm having a lot of troubles right now believing. Jesus, can you, all you have to do is believe. Can you just believe? Can you believe just a little bit? He says, I believe, help my unbelief. And Jesus immediately went to helping his unbelief by curing his son.
Amen.
Amen. I tell you, his faith came to an all-time high after that happened. Hallelujah. And it was a little bit torn up because the disciples were struggling with it because they were compromised with human opinion. You and I get compromised in flowing in the Holy Ghost and doing the miracles of Christ Jesus, compromised with our own human opinion. Usually we don't need any counsel from anyone but ourselves. And we can talk ourselves out of why we can't do it. Why we're not able, why we're not qualified, why we need another 100 years, or whatever. I mean, I don't know. He gave gifts in the ministry.
Yes.
The manifestation of the Holy Ghost is given to every person. He poured out his spirit. All you had to do is speak to the rock and ask for some water. Speak to the rock. The spiritual rock, Paul said, that followed us in the wilderness. Everybody stand with me. Ah, babasaneyateya. I was right at the point of going grabbing some people and jerking them out of their wheelchairs. So I said, I don't see any wheelchairs here. I do. They're spiritual. Get you up walking around instead of wheeling yourself around. Tonight, whatever it is that you have need of, you have someone who loves you more than you love yourself. More than your mother loves you, and your daddy loves you, more than anyone loves you, Christ Jesus, and he's here to meet your need. He's here to touch you. He's here to change you. Those of you who have been baptized in the Holy Ghost and been developed in faith, he's here to show you how to stand up strong to anything that's coming at you. Hallelujah. You lay hold. That means you take it. Huh? You ever seen somebody drowning? And then now they're going to receive a life rope. They don't receive no life rope. They take it. They lay hold on that. Amen. Hallelujah. Receiving nothing. You taking it. I love how Carlos Hedekaniga says, took me. Talk to me. Take it, right? Talk to me. There's too many people that are passive about God. They're just standing there. They're not receiving nothing because they're not taking nothing. They're not laying hold on it. It's mine. The church of the Lord Jesus Christ, which this is, which you are part of, is God's means and God's remedy of dealing with social evils. If the social evils remain, it's because we abdicated. Might as well go ahead and take the responsibility. As far as I'm concerned, I'm not. That just provokes me. I don't go, okay, well, whatever. I'm like, no, I mean, because this is the realm for the strong and the mighty. Those who are strong and mighty because of the strength of the Lord and the power of His might. This is the realm of the strong and the mighty and the bold and brave because they've been filled with the Spirit of the Lord. Hallelujah. Spirit of boldness. Stretch forth your hand, grant that we should have boldness. Amen. I tell you right now, when you get yourself in that kind of a situation, the place is going to be shaken now. When you're ready, because they're like, okay, they told us they're going to kill us if we preach anymore. So, Lord, all we need, we're ready to go. We're ready to do this thing. So just give us some boldness. Just give us some boldness because we need boldness because we're a little intimidated right now. The place was shaken because the Lord saw the heart. They're going. They're going to do this. And He's going to make sure that they do it in such a radical way that no one forgets. And it spreads and it changes governments. In Jesus, in the mighty name of the living God, the power of the Holy Ghost comes upon you. Everything about your life begins to change right now. The spirit of the wisdom and revelation takes hold of you right now in Jesus. Lord Jesus, bless the baby right now. Bless the baby. Thank you, Lord, for the anointing. Touch mama. Si capra basa derene. Ex te benefiti si. Ne mene se pete. Now in Jesus' name, from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, touched by the power of God. Lord Jesus, touch baby. If there's anyone here tonight, you afflicted, you tormented, you hurting, you sick in your body, you get overwhelmed with things and you do not know how to get out of them, I want you to recognize that God the Holy Ghost is here. Jesus sent Him. He's another helper, just like Jesus was when He walked the face of this earth, helping men. Can you imagine how hard it would have been for Peter and James and John to step in a miracle of faith that they hadn't had Jesus' help? Showing them how, demonstrating it for them, doing it on their behalf. God, the Holy Ghost, has come to do something even greater. Same thing, but even greater, to demonstrate, to help us, to show us how to move here. Individually, personally, for the things that He's purposed us to be a part of and the gifts and callings of God upon our life. Which is Christ Jesus. People get confused about that. What's my gift and calling? Jesus. What am I supposed to do in my life? Jesus. The beauty of His life, the beauty and the glory of His life, the joy, the love, the mercy, the grace, the power, the ability, the solution, the provision for all mankind. Come on, stir faith. Let faith be stirred in your heart on a daily basis. Listen, on a continual basis, you do not have time to waste on doubt and unbelief. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that you get fighting mad every time doubt and unbelief presents itself to you. You know what? I'm pretty quiet. I'm pretty easygoing. I mean, I think I am. I certainly don't raise much fuss or any fuss at all if people just rattling off a bunch of stuff, and I'm not going to defend myself, that's for sure. But Let me hear a bunch of doubt and unbelief coming out of getting God, of God's people's mouth around me, and I'm going to start letting it, I will start letting it go. I will not tolerate doubt and unbelief. I don't give myself to it. Keep your heart with all diligence. People, just go ahead. Just go ahead from this day forward and allow God, the Holy Spirit, more liberty in your life. Quit giving yourself to all these other things. Give Him some time. Let Him mature you. Let Him build you up in faith. The gift of faith is a glorious and wonderful thing. Hallelujah. 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 I want you to be strengthened and refreshed right now. See, the times of refreshing have come. From the presence of the Lord. So you just go ahead and be refreshed. You go ahead and be strengthened and refreshed. Watch things change. I guarantee you God will so strengthen you that you'll begin to command things to change and they'll change. You'll begin to command situations and circumstances around you and they'll line up to what you decree as you decree them for the purposes of God. I tell you, this is what God will do for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woohoo! Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Kambos de Karanea. Hallelujah. Now, if there's anybody who wants prayer, I want you to come. We'll pray with you and for you. The Lord will touch you. You touch heaven. I see most of the people that are coming right now, you baptized in the Holy Ghost already. I mean, my goodness, you can get it done. Right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. And babies to be blessed. Hallelujah. Gambrom jele shikarna mane. Bandolo bokoshe bredeya. Legarama. Let me just see a hand a little bit more. Banje rishande. Jesu rabasara dakaya la mahai. Hallelujah. Irababasaya. In a mandaneste. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Yeah, I see that finger straightening out. I see that calcification in those deposits going out, the joint softening. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Be strong. Be strong. Be strong. Receive right now. Let that God outside. Let that glory overwhelm you. Let that glory of the Holy Ghost overwhelm you. Let the power of the Holy Ghost touch you. Let the power of God overwhelm you. Let the glory of God overwhelm you. Just set by kindness. Hallelujah. Church, just begin to pray. That's powerful. That's powerful. Hallelujah. The fire of the Holy Ghost. The fire of the Holy Ghost upon your enemy. Fire. Fire. Presence. Authority right now in Jesus' name. Jesus. King Ban Jang Rosai. Sataramaya. Zeleneme. In Jesus' name. Get passionate, man. In it now. Just go ahead and stir passion for God up in your life. That's right. Just stir passion up. Just stir up the fire. Fire of the Holy Ghost. Come on, James. Fire! Right now, Jesus. Out of your belly flows. Yes, dear. Okay, baby, and we're going to just pray right now. Father, we thank you for using faith to see the nations change. Hallelujah. Mambra zaradeya brahmangaras. What is it that you need? Miracle faith is here for you. Jesus is here for you right now. Just see the change. Call it done. See the change. Call it done. Divine power and ability is here for you right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Just so fired up with the word of life. So hungry, so thirsty. That everything that belongs to the kingdom of God is yours. Isha Rabba Baba Sarame. Isha Babra Baba Saramane. Isha Rabba Baba Baba Rasamane. Isha Rabba Baba Baba Saramane. Write down the name of Jesus. Power of God comes upon you. Thing about your life begins to take on the splendor and the glory of heaven. Zuko Ramanje Zilana Maneshi Bakaranora. Menananjeli Bakara Sabrati Yaramasoro. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Faith. Faith. Fiery. Holy Ghost, faith! Jesus. 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 Jesus.
and Jesus, authority over sickness and disease. Authority over every power of torment in Jesus' name. Authority to do the works of Jesus, to stand in His place, speak His word, see those things which He's declared come to pass. Sikata la la manjesi para soto ko yarama manjesi dolulubusaria. Zirama mamandese likasta rabaye. Urababa sitaranea si. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Stir up that spirit of prayer and supplication. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for the spirit of judgments. Aramain and burning, so God. Mala mandera. La mandarosaranea. Urabasagaranebre. Authority. 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 Thank you, Father, for the realms of heaven. Thank you, Father, for the realms of glory. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, I command the blessings of God upon you. There be no more harassments and torments, but confidence and boldness in Jesus' mighty name. As these great rivers of the Spirit of the Lord pour out of you, flow through you, you begin to enjoy the riches of God, the riches of fellowship with the Holy Ghost. Zazareya barasando. Hallelujah. Mandalekeya. Woo! Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. These things are yours. They belong to you. Thank you, Father, for the miracles. Thank you, Father, for the signs and wonders. Thank you, Father, for the glory of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Woo-hoo! Man, Jacobaya. Faith. Faith. Mambrombandaseya. Mambrombrasatara. The gushings of the Holy Ghost. The great outpourings of the Spirit of the Lord. Minjala satagi brebesh. Zurra bara, Jesus Zurra venanda le debre vekere mosusto. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Right out of your belly flows these rivers of the Holy Ghost, these floodgates of heaven, floodgates of heaven. In Jesus' mighty name. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Ha ha! Ha ha ha! Renengelibashe. The glory of heaven fills you. Father, we thank you for taking this life and lighting this life up with the fire of heaven. Man, Jesus. Man, Jesus. Man, Jesus. Just lift your hands towards heaven. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, you're not going to allow the grace of God to be bestowed upon you in vain. It's not going to be about just another time of coming and getting filled up. It's going to be rather about a time of beginning to move in bold faith and obedience to the Word of God with a great authority. No longer to be pushed around, shoved around, knocked around, but rather to stand up and wear the crown of authority, of divine power and ability to do the works of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. It's time to call a nation to repentance. Beginning with the church, the community of the church. It's time to take that which you've received and begin to give. Begin to freely give with greater confidence, with greater boldness. Just go around and just give. Give life. Give strength. Give deliverance. Give release to the captives and to those that are in prison. It's time to stand up and do what Christ Jesus gave us the authority to do. And know that He's going to do the works. Hallelujah. He's going to do the works. All you and I have to do is stand in the place and speak on His behalf. In Jesus' name. From this day forward. Hallelujah. No more tossed. Lift your hands towards heaven. No more tossed. No more tossed. Say no more tossed. Just living in you, Lord Jesus. Being filled continually. Be filled now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord 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 Jesus. Like a mighty wind. Like a mighty wind. Like a mighty wind. Like a mighty wind. Like a mighty man. Jesus. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' mighty name. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. The Lord Jesus did not call you to be passive with the circumstances and the things about you, the lives of people, the situations. He commanded you to be in charge. He commanded you to speak to whatever is going on around you. And demand that it obey the Word of God. And demand that it be conformed to what Father in heaven has already decided it should be. So that's all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. That's life forevermore. That's joy unspeakable and full of glory. That's provision that's more than enough. That's all sufficiency in all things. See, anytime I need something, anytime we need something, I know we already got it. Because, see, I've received from the Lord Jesus Christ the blessing that I should have all sufficiency in all things. And so when the situation and circumstances tries to tell me I don't ignore it, I smash it. And I speak the word of faith and I move in faith. I just step out. I deal very actively with lying words. Things that are contrary to what Father has described and spoken. So you do that too now, okay? So lift your hands towards heaven and just let the Lord stir you in the gift of faith. That's right, just let Him stir you in the gift of faith. You see, there's just no, there's nothing that can stop faith. There's nothing. There's never been a doubt created that's bigger than faith. Thank you, Jesus, for the anointing. 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 Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Holy Spirit's walking around here looking for those who He can empower with a greater outworking in their life. Is that going to be you, Clara? Are you afraid? You scared of anything? I don't think you're scared of nothing either. So just be in charge, Claire. Be in charge. Just be in charge. You demand things. I see it in you. I see that you can stand up and demand things to obey the Word of God. Command everything to come in alignment with what God has spoken. So you just do it. You're empowered now. You don't have to wait. You don't have to ask for permission. You're empowered. Jesus. You too, Zoe. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Magarast ekilina. Lift him up higher. That's half mass. That's something that someone died. Just take hold right now. Take hold this. Take hold this wonderful provision. Take it. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Joy unspeakable and full of glory, great confidence and boldness in the faith, change in every dimension of your life. I tell you, it's so, it's done. All you have to do is believe it. That's what Father's declared. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Is there anybody I didn't pray for? I think if I didn't pray for you and you wanted prayer, raise your hand so I can see you and I will come that direction. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I want you to be filled with the Spirit right now. Begin to speak with, to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. I want you to go ahead and be filled with the Spirit right now. I want you to build up yourself in your most holy faith right now, praying in the Holy Ghost. Now listen to me. That's strong and that's beautiful. And the more you do it, the stronger it becomes and the more it expresses the divine authority of God. But let me tell you, as you also give yourself to being filled with the Spirit, speaking yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, it will come just as easy and just as that quick and just as that effortless. Can you remember the time back when, before you were baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of the divine language, how hard it was? You're just standing there trying, but nothing's happening. Wonder what's wrong with you. Hey, remember that frustrating feeling? But now it's like it just as easy. Come on, man. We'll just pray in the Holy Ghost. Come on. We'll just go all night kind of thing, right? Same way with all the rest of the gifts of the Spirit. You just got to give place to them. He gave gifts unto men. Gifts of the Holy Ghost according to His own will. The manifestation of the Holy Spirit that is given to every man. And in Jesus' name, you're going to begin to give yourself over to these things. You're going to begin to talk to the Holy Ghost like this. And just begin to speak to the Holy Spirit and ask Him, Lord, show me how it is to speak in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs because I'm ready, fill my mouth. Hallelujah. And then what's going to happen is you'll start praying, just like I told you, praying the Holy Ghost till the peace comes. Or if you're not walking in peace, or till the joy comes, if you're not walking in the joy. You're just praying the Holy Ghost until the psalm comes. You're praying the Holy Ghost until the hymn comes. And then all of a sudden, until the spiritual song comes. And then all of a sudden, you'll find yourself immediately able to go there. You'll find yourself immediately able to go over into joy, get raptured in joy. It's a wonderful thing to wake up in the morning and be raptured in joy before you ever get out of bed. It's wonderful to start walking towards people that you might have been intimidated about walking towards to give them a hug, but as you're walking towards them, you're blanketed with the glory of God. And now you give them a Holy Ghost hug right from heaven. It's just not even you, because the Lord busts an alabaster box of anointing over top of your head and it flows over every part of your being, spirit, soul, and body. I'm telling you, these are the things that God has for us to mature in. It's not, no one's been left out. I know it's hard to believe that no one's been left up. I know it's hard to believe that you can have the gifts of the Holy Ghost. I know it's hard to believe that you can have this kind of empowerment. But you just begin to give yourself to that which God has given, and you're going to see a maturation. And in that maturity and in that giving yourself to these things of the Holy Ghost, the hindrances just vaporize. And the things that have stood in the way in the past, they just become like neon flashing lights, and you go, you ugly thing, get out of here. Rather than trying to, you know, like I said, on Sunday night, you can't see Him without revelation. You can't see Him. You don't know Him. You won't even know how to deal with it. But just give yourself to that which God commands, and watch what happens. Oh, bravo, Siki. Every one of you that want to see this nation change, obey God. Every one of you that want to see the evil that is going on broken down, do what God said. Be filled with the Spirit. Redeem the time for the day of evil. Don't be drunk with wine where is in excess, but be filled with the Spirit. That is redeeming power. That's what God says. It's the ability now to begin to pray in the intercessions of the Holy Ghost after what the Holy Ghost wants to pray for the United States of America for the communities of the United States of America. Oh. We'll begin to overwhelm you, begin to flood your soul. We're going to do this. You're going to do this. You're going to be more bold to speak out than ever before. Yep. Listen, I'm telling you right now, you're going to be more bold to speak out than ever before. You're going to be more bold to speak out than ever before. The Lord takes little, frail, small people like Brittany and makes them the giants that tower over the mighty men of the earth. That's what the Lord does. You hear me? You hear me? You hear me, Brittany?
Yes.
The Lord takes little Brittany to tower over the mighty men of the earth. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Because your reliance and your trust is totally in Him. Because your confidence is totally in Him. You've already fully got the fact that you can do nothing of yourself. You have been already fully persuaded of this. It's not a lesson that you learn, have to learn. Some people are still having to learn the lesson that they can do nothing of themselves. But as you talk to the Holy Ghost, He can advance the process to where that you get it quick. And just say, you know, you say, Lord, I don't really get it. How that I can do nothing of myself, because I feel like I can. Help me see, Lord, where I can, and He will. Just do it. You start saying, Lord, I don't want to make this decision on my own. Lord, I don't want to decide. You tell me. Show me. Let me hear You speak. Lead me. It may seem like at first that you're really not getting a response from the Holy Ghost. You are, but you're not discerning enough. You just keep talking to Him, and He empowers you, gives you the ability to discern what He's saying, to hear Him. Because understand, when you live by the five senses, it literally clouds your ability to function in the spiritual senses. Because it's like someone speaking so loud over top of a small, quiet type person. But when you begin to shut down decision making based on your five senses, Lord, touch that baby. Bring that baby here. When baby's crying, it's saying, Pastor, I need You desperately to come pray for me. That's what the babies say. That's what they do. And it works. It's the same in every language. Korean, Swahili, Japanese. Doesn't matter. It's all the same. You know, when people bring their children to the Lord, when people bring their children to the Lord, like Hannah did for dedication, they're giving their children to the church. I've watched as so many of God's people go give their children to the state. Oh yeah, 8 hours a day in school. Give their children to the state. They won't give their children to the church. But when you really dedicate your children to the Lord, you're giving them to the church and to the leadership of the church. I really want to see people in the church of the Lord Jesus Christ do it right. And quit holding on. Say, well, you know, you've got to, here's what, you know, parents say, well, you've got to listen to me. You can't listen to your leader at the church. You've got to run it by me first. No, they don't. I guarantee you, most of what the teachers at school are telling them, they're not running it by you first. It don't seem like you got much of a problem with that, so I'd say that's an indication of a whole lot of deception going on. Wouldn't you?
Amen.
I would say that's an indication of a demon power having influence in the midst of the church. I command this baby to be healed and his stomach to function right, and every part and member to work right, and to be so full of the anointing of the Holy Ghost. And that I thank You, Father, that Your servants, Jeremy and Julie, are going to dedicate their kids to the church, Your house. Hallelujah, they're going to give them to the church. You know, you take your kids home, and on the way home, you just go, well, I just don't agree what the pastor said. You know what you just did? You just took away from your children the ability to submit to the house of the Lord. You just planted within them a spirit to criticize and to rebel against the house of the Lord. It happens all over the place. It's happening everywhere. It's Satan's design. It's what he's done. And that's why it is like a labor of revival miracle to see a church come to a place where the biggest hindrance of the flow of the Holy Ghost is strife and division. Understand? Unity of spirit and the bond of peace, being together in agreement and one accord, is absolutely essential to the glory of Father being revealed in the midst of the church collectively. It's just essential. That's why many times we'll say, okay, let's just, you know, right now, like I just said, go ahead and begin to flow in these special anointings, and everybody just stuck. It's stuck. People are stuck because of the things that have spiritually been allowed. I wanted to say this. God has called me and every pastor and minister like me to teach the people of God how to walk in the Spirit, how to walk in the Holy Ghost. That's our whole job. That's what we do. You can be an evangelist and call people into the kingdom of God so that they can begin to walk in the Spirit. But the bottom line of it is the whole message is about teaching people to walk in the Holy Ghost. In that, some of the most important things that we emphasize are those things that hinder or stop that function and flow of the Spirit of the Lord, or those things that give place to Him in a place of submission and yieldedness so He can be in charge and do what He wants to do. The biggest church that Jesus was able to see that unity happen in that we know about was 120. But there's greater works for the last days. Now I'm telling you, once again, we can see very clearly that the light of the gospel, that the light of the church, that the salt of the church has not been effective in the United States of America. Thus, you must be committed to participating with the church as the church of the Lord Jesus Christ with the purposes of God, giving yourself to creating an atmosphere of faith, giving yourself to not allow on any of these things, these evil things, to work through you. Because I don't care what flavor the evil is. As far as I'm concerned, strife and sedition and criticism and envy, they all named right there in the same category with those who do not have an inheritance of the kingdom of God, like the homosexual and the adulterer. It's all the same. You better understand where you've yielded your members to uncleanness and repent if you have. If you've unyielded yourself, if you've allowed those things to work in your mind and your thinking, give them here. If you've allowed those things to work in your mind and your thinking, Papa, how many rocks did you eat today? You like weigh 100 pounds. He's a buster, I'm telling you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Just walk in the Spirit. And you should not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. This is what we've been privileged to do. I know you're going to do it. I can see it in some of your eyes. I can see it. Some of you, I know you're still like, you're still, there's a question mark and a self-justification. I've watched you. I know what the spirit of self-justification is. I want to help you. But God cannot even help you unless you want Him to. I'm telling you right now, if you don't give your children to the church, the bottom line of it is, the default is the world takes them. Who didn't I pray for? Someone I didn't pray for. Come. Everyone I didn't pray for, I want you to come. If I didn't lay hands on you, I want you to come stand right here. Anyone else? Is there just one person I didn't lay hands on? Oh, two people, three people, four people, five people, six, seven people, eight people. Good. It's good to see you. Honest, everyone that's standing here right now, just like raise your hands to us. Heaven. So that you can just begin to receive heaven like never before. So that everything in your spirit and everything in your life is just made right. So that all that Father has purposed to enrich you with in Christ Jesus is yours. All the glory, all the authority, all the power, all the faith. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the anointing. Thank you for the anointing. Thank you, Jesus, for the anointing. Thank you for the anointing. Thank you, Jesus. I'm blind, just a crumb. Sivri dashti. See, the Lord says, in His presence is fullness of joy, and at His right hand are pleasures forevermore. And I'm telling you, as you begin to enjoy them, nothing else can satisfy, and neither do you want anything else. Labrosta kesht, labrosta karanai, labrosta break. Healed from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Touched. Right now. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. That cloud of glory will just keep getting thicker and thicker as you walk in it. Yes, Lord. You know, what I can hear, what I hear there is I actually hear an intercession for the church, for this church. It's an intercession. Because there have been parents who've not been willing to give their kids to the church. There have been people in here who have held back out of fear, out of suspicion, and have not entrusted themselves to the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. And don't even understand the dynamics and the impacts of that. But isn't God so good that the Holy Ghost don't let up and He don't give up? He cleans up. Hallelujah. And he works with us until we say, Lord, I surrender. I've been in the way too long. I've been trying to play. I played God too long. Father can't be your protector when you are. Huh? He can't be your provider when you are. He can't be your healer when you are. But when we begin to look at him, when we begin to trust him with everything that we have. Hallelujah. 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 I just pray that every one of you, this is a burning word in me right now because I heard it by the Spirit of the Lord a few minutes ago. Be like Hannah. We need to see great men and women of God raised up in this next generation. Because you think you've seen a decay. I mean, in the social structure, if the Lord allowed the thing to go on and did not intervene, the people who would be the most focal target of this onslaught of iniquity will be the children. We need to see, in the midst of this, Samuel's raised up. We need to see Deborah's raised up. We need to see mighty men and women of God. And that ain't going to happen unless there's going to be Hannahs, people who know God enough to give their children to church. Well, somebody said, I don't give my children to Eli. Well, you're not giving your children to Eli. You're giving them to God. Besides that, I'm not Eli. And I'm going to tell you right now, I would not allow a leadership of Eli in this place. And I'm blessed. I'm blessed by the radicalness. I'm blessed by the intensity that has been developed in Brad Scott's life, in Amy Scott's life. And you might go into that, you might go into a children's church and hear it going, coming down. And I'm praise God, he's addressing evil spirits that start messing with kids at a very young age. And sometimes it's evil spirits that have been already operating in Christian homes. I'm happy for that. Yeah. Get after it, man. And I'll tell you right now, you touch one of them, you touching God. And you think, and if you self-justify and say, well, you know, you can, then you just die in your sin. I'm going to tell you right now, you don't touch the things of God. I don't care what house it's in. It's not, I'm not only talking about this house, I'm talking about every house of God. Every place where God's people are set on pressing in to having it God's way in sincerity and truth. And it isn't about merchandising people. It seems like more places are that people make merchandise out of folks, the more folks flock there. The more people you shouldn't trust, that's the ones people trust. And the people you can trust, people don't trust them because it's just this prince of the power of the air. Satan fights hardest against that place where the anointing's at work. He does. And so I want you to understand that God, the Holy Ghost, is on a mission around here to break off the hindrances and the things that would stand in the way from you fully flowing in all the glory of the gifts of the Holy Ghost and the provision and supply in heaven, both you and your whole house, to where that there can be, God says, he says, rise and shine. Your light has come. The glory of the Lord has risen upon you like the rising of the noonday sun. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We the cure. People are getting all excited about who's going to be president. We the cure. Don't you be looking at nothing other than us being the cure. And that is a result, direct result of you and I being willing to flow in the Holy Ghost, giving ourselves over to the Spirit of the Lord so that he can build us up. What did Paul say? I commend you, I give you over to the Word and to the Holy Ghost, which is able to build you up so that you may have this same inheritance that has been given to all the saints in light. I commend you in the Word of His grace. Huh? Which is able to build you up. Amen. Hallelujah. So give yourself to these things. be those who are conformed to the image of Christ. Be those who are living epistles of His Word, because everything that is in His Word, you live it. You just give yourself to it. Amen. Well, find a bunch of people around you, hug them, tell them that you love them. I go long like this because I break off yokes with the Word. Amen. We see revelation and strength come by the Word. I love having a big old meal. This is a five-course meal. Well, this isn't a five-course night. This is just a three-course. Hallelujah. Don't forsake giving. Just worship the Lord with your giving. Just always.